Hey everybody, my name is Aaron Cato, and I am an Extension Specialist in Horticulture IPM at the University of Arkansas System Division of Agriculture. Today we wanted to update two previous videos that focused on preventing strawberry fruit rot in commercial strawberry production that we put out in 2022 and 2023. Those videos mainly focused on botrytis fruit rot or gray mold and anthracnose fruit rot. And those are still huge issues in our production systems and plasticulture strawberries. However, we have a new disease on the block that is Neopestalotiopsis. So we wanted to talk about how to manage those fruit rots while also managing Neopestalotiopsis or Pestalotia leaf spot, fruit rot, and crown rot while we still have those spring spray schedules. So let's get started. So just as a reminder of the two diseases that we're generally trying to manage, we have botrytis fruit rot and anthracnose fruit rot. Generally, botrytis fruit rot is going to impact flowers. So the botrytis pathogen will infect flowers, and then you will see this gray mold fungus or botrytis fruit rot fungus later. And so you'll oftentimes will see it on developing fruit or after you put it in clamshells or someone buys it, but that isn't due to infection at the flowering stage. Whereas anthracnose fruit rot, the coleotrichum pathogen can actually infect developing flowers and kill them, developing green fruit, and actually cause those salmon or dark spot, maybe like black or brown colored spots or lesions on green fruit or even on red fruit. Whereas botrytis fruit rot, well, you will only see that cause from on ripe fruit whenever there is some type of injury to the berry itself. So how do we prevent these? You know, we're going to talk about our preventative fungicide spray schedule, but I really would be remiss if I didn't talk about cultural control or what you can do to set up your field and your production systems to prevent some of these issues. Now, they will be need to use together, and this is how we talk about when we say IPM or integrated management, but you know, you don't want to just use fungicides and not consider some of the things you can do. So first, try to increase airflow, whether that's by using raised beds, plastic on beds to try to help prevent weeds, trying to manage weeds in plant holes and enrolled middles, or just trying to make sure your rye that you're planting in between lorrows aren't getting too tall. Rotate areas where you plant. They can help knock down some of the amount of the disease you'll see. We generally recommend skipping every 2 to 3 years in between planting strawberries in an area. Don't work plants when they are wet. Things like anthracnose really need moving, splashing water. We have plenty of that in the Southeast and Mid-South. However, whenever you go and hit a plant accidentally with your hand and it's wet, you are now the vehicle that's moving that that fungus around that's causing these diseases. Avoid excessive irrigation. That'll stress plants and make them more prone to disease. And excessive nitrogen, which will make bigger canopies that are harder, more stuffy, and more likely to stay wet. And try to use drip irrigation when possible. You really want to avoid wetting plants anytime that you can, because we know that a lot of this disease is a function of how long our leaves are wet. And lastly, we do recommend removing dead leaves, flower, and fruit in the winter prior to warm up, because this will reduce the inoculums in the field or the amount of pathogen that can cause disease in the field. And we also recommend this for Neopestalotiopsis. But there's been some work to show that removing leaves can reduce your yield at the end. However, we're not talking about leaves that are going to give you anything else. We're talking about dead leaves that have some pathogens still surviving on them. Don't go out and remove a bunch of green leaves. That's not going to get you very far. Try to remove what we usually see in our area that's killed by a lot of our deep freezes, that dead leaves, flowers, and fruit that were, you know, put out in the fall that weren't going to do anything. So we talked a little bit about it already, but Neopestalotiopsis is a big issue that's just really kind of come onto the scene. It's caused by species of fungus that are called Neopestalotiopsis species. It's not very well understood. We think that a lot of it is caused by this rosy species, but we're really not sure. A lot of work's being done by Natalia Perez's group down in Florida, and we're hopeful that they can shed some more insight on this issue. We know that these species of fungus have been around forever. They really haven't caused much disease, or I say forever, but for a long time, and they haven't really caused much disease, but something has shifted and caused them to become a much more aggressive disease. Probably often we'll say the aggressive strains of these pathogens. And those aggressive strains were first found in 2018 to 2020 down in Florida and then other areas like Georgia and North Carolina. And a lot of this was coming out of specific nurseries. This year, though, almost every nursery that we deal with has had outbreaks of this disease, a lot of it starting from some of the very first plant sources up the line of the chain. And so we know that a lot of nurseries actually told growers that, you know, we have high levels of inoculum. You can cancel your orders if you want to. But we do know is that a lot of people still wanted to grow strawberries. And so this is, you know, our goal is to try to help you be successful in that. What we've seen so far in Arkansas and some of the surrounding areas is a little bit of plant collapse through fall and the winter. And I'll show a picture picture on the next slide from what that kind of looks like, some reddening of leaves. And this is pretty, normally what could this come back as is Neopestalotiopsis, and it's a crown rot. And what happens is there's an infection, it lies latent, and then whenever there's plant stress, we'll say putting on fruit, like we saw a little bit in our hot fall, or even the deep freeze we first saw in the winter, which is a little plant stress due to the cold temperatures. We saw some plants collapse after that. There's a picture of an example on the right, is a Camarosa plant from, I believe that was out in near Clarksville, Arkansas. So what can you do about NEOP? We say practice extreme sanitation. You don't want to move this thing around. So rogue any dying plants or destroy dying plants outside of the field. So pull them out, take them somewhere else, destroy them, clean your hands afterwards. Remove all old leaves, flowers, and fruit before it warms up. And when I say old, I mean the ones that are dead. And then work or pick the cleanest areas first and sanitize the workers, anybody who's picking between fields. You don't want to move this stuff around. Get your hands on thyrium, switch, rime, and tilt. So these are fungicides. These are the only ones that are really effective for NEOP. They're not very great in comparison to what you may would hope that they would be, but they do a decent job. The other one that I don't have mentioned here that I'll mention later is Inspire Super. And make sure you're using these every 7 days in the spring. They need to be used in the fall as well, whenever after planting and whenever it's still warm, but in the spring especially, around rainfall when it's warm. That's our whole spring, so you need to be using the whole spring. That's questions about row covers and the use in the winter. We know we have to use row covers because if not, we're going to lose, you know, plant health. Like it's about to be down, you know, under 15 degrees in some places in the next week. We know plants will lose yields if you don't use them, but there could be some risk of moving around NEOP with these. We had questions about storage of row covers. I would say that you're probably fine to store them, but you want to make sure that they have as least amount of detritus on them, so soil or plant material on the row covers as possible. And also think about storing them in warmer areas. There's been some work that where they can find the NEOP spores on some of these row covers after they've been stored for a while, but those are in cooler areas. When they put them into like storage containers for the summer, anything above like 120 degrees Fahrenheit is really killing out those spores with its extended periods of time. So let's talk about the spray schedule. Preventative sprays during bloom are critical. Gray mold caused by botrytis, or botrytis fruit rot basically is what we a lot of times we would call it. It is due to infection of the botrytis pathogen at bloom. So we want to make sure that we are really stringent on our weekly schedule when we get to around 5% bloom or when it's starting up. You may consider applications prior to this if we get early warm-ups, even if you know you're not going to keep flowers, to suppress NEOP and botrytis. The other thing I want to mention is that you're not just suppressing botrytis at this time, you're also suppressing a buildup of pathogen from anthracnose. So even though it's not the biggest issue, you still want to make sure you have applications of fungicides going out that are effective for both. But the big focus is going to botrytis and Neopestalotiopsis early. Make sure every week you have products for all three of those. And I would really highly recommend considering tank mixing applications with Captan or Thyrum every single week, because then you know that you have some efficacy for Neopestalotiopsis. Thyrum is much better than Captan for NEOP. However, you don't get very many uses if you're west of the Mississippi River of Thyrum, so you may have to use Captan instead. Captan does a really good job helping out with anthracnose and botrytis, and there's actually been some work to show that it's decent on NEOP. It's not giving you as much as Thyrum, but it's giving you something. So it being in the tank with other things that are effective is going to potentially help you out. And a rotate your effective modes of action. So that's going to be your FREC groups. If you are dealing with botrytis or anthracnose that's resistant and you put out the same thing several times in a row, so say you put out Fontellus, then you put out Kenya, then you put out Lunasensation. If it's a botrytis pathogen that's resistant to group 7 fungicides, then you are getting no control. So you'll see a crazy amount of buildup. That's why, or including things like Captan and Thyrum, can get you a long way, because there's no resistance to Captan and Thyrum that we know of, and it's a multi-site, and so adding that in is going to help try to prevent some of those issues. Lastly, I just really want to plug again the 2024 Southeast Regional Strawberry Guide. By the time you see this, the 2025 one may be out, but go to smallfruits.org. This is where a lot of this information comes from, and also info on managing a lot of other diseases and insects that I'm not talking about today. So let's get started. On the right, I'm going to show you a list of fungicides that I think are what you effectively would be potentially including into your spray schedule. You can see everything bolded with the asterisk is what we are saying is effective for helping to suppress Neopestalotiopsis. So Switch, Inspire Super, Thyrium, Rime, and Tilt. You can see functionally we have group 3s and group 9s, our MO3, which is our multi-site Thyrium, and then you know, there's some debate on whether or not we're actually getting the nines or if it's really just group three there. And so Rhyme and Teal are going to be our true group threes. And then we have our combos of Inspire Super and Switch. I would say that Switch you want to save as a rotation partner when you're considering anthracnose and botrytis, but also try to utilize it as a effective spray for Neo-P from week to week. And so it has been found to be really good by itself, but you only get 4 to 5 applications. And so you don't want to use that in the fall. So let's get started on kind of how you would throw these things together. So here's an example, first, second, and third spray. This is not set in stone. This is not what you have to do, but it's just a way to think about rotating these modes of action based on what you want to include in getting through a full year. So we previously recommended to folks, and I'll show you at the end, using 3 to 4 applications of thyrum in the fall. You know, 1 to 2 applications, that would leave 1 to 2 applications in the spring. If you say use 3, then you're going to have 2 left. If you use 4, use 1. We're going to go off the assumption that people use 3 to 4 and probably 4 with the schedule, and so that would only leave you 1. Now, if you are east of the Mississippi River, you still have several left. You would still have 8 applications and can make it almost all the way through the schedule without having to utilize much else. I would still recommend going Captan along with products, even if you are not, say you have Tilt plus lunisensation, something like that. Captan still is potentially going to help. And so what our growers have seen is you still maybe want to add that in. So we started off with Switch. We're using the 11-ounce rate. And that is because at 11 ounces, you get 5 applications. I think that's a necessity in a world where Neo-P is an issue. Second spray, we're going to rotate into Captan plus Elevate plus Rhyme. Captan is going to give us some efficacy on anthracnose. Elevate is going to give us really good control on botrytis, which is our main focus at the second week where we're just into flowering. And then Rhyme is going to be our Neo-P additive. I would not use Tilt until a little later because it can potentially have a growth regulator effect. And that's also why we're not recommending these in the fall. And so you want to save that until you know you got a good enough growth on your plants. Then for the third spray, you can just rotate back to Switch Captan, which is going to give you really good anthracnose, botrytis, and Neo-P suppression, or use something like Thyram plus Kenya. So Kenya is going to give you that botrytis, Thyram is going to give you Neopestalotiopsis and help you out on the anthracnose side as well. So here you can see we went with Switch Captan Elevate Rhyme, Switch Captan. Then we rotated back to Captan plus Elevate plus Tilt. We really try to use our Elevate early because it only helps with botrytis. And then that fourth spray, you can see Captan plus Tilt is giving us anthracnose, and then Tilt's giving us going to give a Neo-P suppression. And then the fifth spray, I think, is where you start using your good anthracnose products. And so things like lunisensation, Maravon, Mievers Prime, or the single site would be Cabrio. At pyrocostrobin is really good on, are found to be good in suppressing anthracnose fruit rot. But you would want to mix this with something. So we didn't use Thyram. Like I said, we could have in the earlier work. So now we would consider mixing Thyram with one of these products. So something like lunisensation, Thyram would be a really good application for gray mold, for anthracnose, and for Neo-P. We don't often recommend Mirvis Prime because of the cost and also because every use of Mirvis Prime is technically taking away a use of Switch due to them sharing an active ingredient. And here I just want to just kind of skip on to the full schedule. I want to remind you again to read the label. These are all what we have for use in Arkansas. It's probably very similar or the same in your state, but it's possible that it's not. You can see that we went with lunisensation plus Captan, or lunisensation plus Thyram, and then the sixth spray Switch Captan. And then we just tried to rotate down the line using Switch, comboed in with our products that are good for anthracnose. You may need more applications than this, but you know that application 1 through 4 is going to get you through March. That 5 through 8 is going to get you through April, and then there's 3 more applications in May. And so I think that for most people, this will get them most of the way. But you know, just like last year, what a lot of people found is we started early, and then some people were able to extend. So you know, 11, 12, 13 applications is not unheard of, especially if we get into late February and it warms back up, early March, things like that. And so you may have to use something like Captan plus Rhyme early if you you know, before the first Switch application to get you further. But I told you I would show you example fall plus spring spray schedule. This is what we shared out in the fall, whenever the first Neo-P issue started up. You can see that we are a little different than some of our counterparts, say in like North Carolina or Georgia, where we recommend a lot of Thyram early. We have a lot of issues in our region with getting a really good amounts of growth in the spring. So it really makes me hesitate to use our group three fungicides at this time. So we recommended using Thyram early. I think that was the right move, but you could use things like Rhyme. I still wouldn't recommend Tilt early and then save some of that Thyram from later. But you can kind of see how that would work out through the whole year. The left side, that's west of Mississippi River, where we only get 5 applications of Thyram. And on the right, that is where, on the east, where it's a lot easier, where you get 12 applications. But one thing to consider is that we may lose thyrim. The EPA is considering banning it, and it's possible that it'll go away. So you may try to think about how you would wrap your mind around making this work without. It's going to be hard, but it may be possible. We may have to try to get some, you know, restricted use items added in, emergency use items would be a better way to say it. With that, I'd be happy to answer any correspondence that, you know, if y'all have any questions, please comment on the video or just, you know, find me online, send me an email or something like that. I'm happy to take a call or anything like that. You can see that I really would advise or, you know, recommend that you check out our Southern Fruitcast, our Arkansas Fruit, Vegetable, and Nut Update, and the Southeast Regional Strawberry Guidebook. Also, I just wanted to throw out some plugs on some other things we made. If you're wondering on, you know, getting a new sprayer or something like that, check out our fact sheet that we just put out. Ryan Kiefer, that works with our program, just made a fact sheet in the YouTube video as well on constructing a cheap and effective strawberry sprayer. So check out our other videos in the YouTube and you'll see how that's done. I think we spent like $170 or something like that taking a regular boom sprayer and making it a very effective item for controlling strawberries. So with that, I appreciate any questions that you may have. Thanks.